Hello, and welcome to Aging Matters, a program presented and sponsored by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. My name is Ann Barlet, and I am the Manager of Community Outreach and Education for the agency. Our topic this evening is on senior scams, don't be a victim. And my special guest tonight is Mr. David Shallcross, who is the, I gotta get all in the title here, Elder Abuse Unit Leader and Education and Outreach Specialist for the Pennsylvania Office of Attorney General. Thank you, David, and now our show's over. Now, between your title and mine. So welcome, thank you so much. It's a shame that, in a sense, that we have to actually talk about this topic and be here to talk about scams and the way people pick on seniors, find seniors somehow, that the seniors in our community fall prey to as a victim to these folks. And unfortunately, it does happen, and there are a variety of scams, and including financial scams, frauds, exploitation, and it's not just out there, you know, we have it in our community as well. So I think it's a great opportunity for us to share some information and hopefully make everybody a little bit more alert to what's happening out there in our community, what are more, I hate to say popular scams, but things that are occurring more frequently to our senior citizens, and how we can best remember those things and protect ourselves, prevent ourselves from being scammed, and then a resource to share and report. So again, Dave, let's jump right in with, because it's seniors and we're senior focused, why? Why are the people targeting seniors and older adults?
Well, it's an excellent question, Ann. And a lot of times we have to think about things such as who has funds? And the criminal is going to look at that as, well, the senior has worked a longer term of life. Mm-hmm. They have that nest egg. They've saved the money. It's available to them. It's a resource, and it's an opportunity. So they look also for a softer target, perhaps someone that might be embarrassed to report that they were scammed or defrauded, someone who might just not remember the details of what has occurred, which would, hopefully for the criminal, that person would be a poor witness. However, law enforcement can encourage that person and assist them with their memory and some of the facts. A lot of times there is a paper trail for law enforcement to pursue a case like that. But the criminal looks at it as if a senior may be a soft target.
Okay. I think that we want to talk a little bit about making the distinction, perhaps, between we talk about scams and maybe just throw out a few ideas, quick, just kind of the names of scams before we talk about each of those scams. And then we don't think of this as a scam, but the financial crimes, the financial exploitation, although it is, let's talk about maybe some of the differences and how they're all still scams and still, you know, falling victim to it.
Absolutely. You know, a lot of times when we discuss fraud versus financial exploitation, the big difference is the perpetrator. In fraud and scams, it's normally a stranger, mm-hmm. someone that the senior doesn't really know, or maybe someone who's portraying someone the senior knows, but it's actually a stranger who's perpetrating the crime. When we talk about financial exploitation, on the other hand, that is quite often a family member, a caregiver, someone who's in authority, that there's a level of trust in that relationship, even a fiduciary responsibility. It could be anyone from caregivers, health aides, it could be an attorney, it could be a funeral director, it could be a financial advisor. So basically, if you're going to look at the difference between the scam and fraud situation and the exploitation, it's does the perpetrator have a relationship existing with the victim?
Which just then blows my mind and makes it even more boggling that somebody who does have a relationship with an individual and takes or sees the opportunity to get monies from them, you know, and that's heartbreaking in terms of knowing it could be a relative or, again, a trusted person that you didn't think that you had to consider or worry about. So what should we do first? Would we like to talk about stay with that topic or go to the types of scams, the other types of scams where people are falling prey to that aren't the unknown perpetrator or criminal?
Certainly, and we can discuss some of these frauds that we see and these scams. And, you know, we get a lot of reports. Unfortunately, there's more that are occurring that aren't reported. Mm-hmm. Big problem. A lot of times the elder adult may feel intimidated by the scammer not to report. Mm-hmm. They may have been threatened. They may also just feel embarrassed. Mm-hmm. They don't want to admit to it. There's that fear of losing your independence. I actually had a program one afternoon at a senior center, and a gentleman said that him and his wife actually were subject to a scam, and they lost $10,000. And I asked, I said, well, of course you reported this. And he shook his head no. And I said, well, could you explain why you wouldn't report a $10,000 loss due to a fraud? And he said, basically, if his son and daughter-in-law had found out, they feared that they would lose that independence. They would be put into a nursing facility and not be able to live in their home. So there's a fear.
And they would claim that you no longer are functioning, you can't really manage your affairs and so on. And that is a shame, because that certainly is not the case, and that in most cases isn't. And the reason it isn't is because there are many, circumstances or situations that a criminal, when they're seeking out a senior, in a sense knows about the general senior. You mentioned the fact that they probably have money because they've scrimped and they've saved and they've put it down. They know that they won't report it, that kind of thing, and they're embarrassed or are afraid of those things. So couple all that together, I think, with some of the things we know in aging, that they might be living alone and so they might be afraid they would be relocated. Some of the natural aging processes of hearing problems, so we're not quite hearing the person on the phone, and so it sounds like it is. The other thing is, you know, if I'm reading something, I've got a little vision issue, and the criminal has made the document look so real and make it look so much like it's something coming from the government and I'm going to, you know, or IRS and I'm going to owe money. So couple all of that and you have a unfortunate target. So let's talk about some of the ones that we hear more about, some of the fraud situations that we're hearing more about to make sure people are aware of these things when they get these phone calls or information in the mail, however it comes to us.
Well, that's true. And, you know, the scams are approached in different mediums. A lot of times it is through the mail, through the telephone, over the internet, and occasionally even in person. Some of these scammers are very brazen. They will actually approach someone outside of a bank or a grocery store and attempt to cause a scam. They may suggest that they're from out of the country or out of town and they don't have a bank account but have received a check or a money order. And they'll ask the older adult, would you process this for me? I'd be glad to pay you a fee for your trouble. Well, you're moving a counterfeit check, perhaps. You put it into the bank, withdraw cash to give it to that individual. They write the check out and sign it to you. You're out your money. Mm. So, I mean, it can be even direct in person. Most of the calls that we receive, I believe, are over the telephone and the mail. Seem to be very popular with the older adults. Some of the scams that we do hear about that are done this way are everything from the IRS scam. That seems to be very popular right around this time of year as we move into tax time in April.
If I may interrupt, I don't like to do that, but you said something there that says as we move into this time of tax time, I think also, don't you think that with that particular scam, and we'll talk about it specifically, the scammers I call them seasonal, in that, okay, there's a time for that makes more sense. Now we're going to do that particular situation fraud on the phone. And then other times of the year or other circumstances or situations cause a whole other group of fraud tactics. So what is the IRS one that's going on right now?
Well, you know, it's going to get more popular and more frequent as we approach tax time in the spring. Right now we're in fall, but we are getting complaints about it already, which is a little surprising this early. But they do look ahead and they start to project, like you said, what season is ripe for what type of scam. So the IRS scam is roughly they contact you and advise that there's been a mistake in your filing of your last tax return. It failed to process correctly and you need to provide personal financial information to rectify the problem, or you could face penalties and fines. And that's to scare someone into cooperating and giving information. So there's that fear factor when they start to address you with, you know, there's a threat of incarceration, fines, or any type of other activity of that nature. So people get upset. nobody wants to mess with the IRS, right?
I was gonna say, yeah.
So, you know, that's a great angle for the criminal to utilize against anyone, okay, regardless of your age. We hear that, yep, scam from many different, okay, people. We move into the March time frame, which is going to be coming later in the year, and you'll have the Irish sweepstakes scam, where people are going to believe that they may have won the sweepstakes and there's a prize, and they're going to be instructed, of course, to provide front money to pay for taxes and any type of servicing fees or delivery fee, and that's just not right. It's against the law to be forced to pay money up front to receive a prize from, okay, a legitimate contest, sweepstakes, or lottery.
Because we're hearing, you know, I also do some of the programs and educational programs on scams, and I've also been at senior groups, and one was similar to that with the lottery and those scams in terms of they get a call and they say, oh, you've won this prize of X amount of dollars, and in order to get it, you need to send this amount to get that. And you shouldn't have to send money to get money, right?
Exactly.
That, yeah, doesn't sound right there to me.
And a lot of times they'll even go a step further, and if it's through the mail, we've seen these with an actual check enclosed, mm-hmm, claiming to be a forward payment of your first installment of your,
wow,
big winnings.
Oh.
And of course, that is to help you facilitate paying those taxes, and you're basically processing a bad check. It's either a counterfeit check, or it could even be perhaps a hijacked account, which it has an actual account number, an actual routing number, but, mm, there's no funds. It's not going to be supported. The, mm-hmm, bank will determine that in a few days to be insufficient, and you will be the responsible party for those losses.
Wow.
And we've seen these checks up over $4,000. You know, and when you're subject to that, that's a significant loss for a lot of our older adults, mm-hmm, and that can change your quality of life.
Definitely.
A lot of people have to be cautious. Yeah. Never process a check under duress or quickly. Always be sure of its origin. And if you didn't enter the contest, you didn't win the contest.
Exactly. That's, yeah, one of the things that I've heard so many times. I've said, you know, I even said that I received calls already, and luckily for an answering machine, the messages have been left that you've won a cruise and, you know, call this number. And I go, I didn't even enter. So how can you win if you didn't enter? You have to, you know, play to get
win.
The
yeah. Yeah.
All righty. Well, how about another one? What's some of the other ones? Anything?
Yeah, we still are seeing the grandparent scam, which has been around for a long time now, actually. Mm-hmm. The grandparent scam nationally has over 25,000 reports, and we're looking at over $110 million in losses.
Wow.
Now, the sad part is only 8% of the victims that we know of have reported, and that's an estimate, you know, through the Federal Trade Commission. We do know that it is something that goes on locally. I get, mm-hmm, complaints of it every day, and basically it works in this context that you're receiving a phone call or a text message that there's a family member in trouble. Quite often, if it's an older adult that they're reaching out to, they'll pretend to be the grandchild.
Mm-hmm.
They may not know the name of the grandchild, but we have that habit of offering information without thinking.
Yes.
And when that caller says, "Grandmom, it's me."
Yeah.
And you go, "Jimmy?"
Yes.
Now you provided the scammer with additional detail, yep, that they're going to use to continue to build the fraud. And there's going to be a problem. Jimmy's either in jail, mm-hmm, had a car accident with a rental car, perhaps, and what do they need to get out of trouble?
Money.
Right? So that's where it becomes the issue, where grandmom is now sent to the bank to withdraw funds, or grandpa, you know, they'll, mm-hmm, do either way,
mm-hmm,
and then you're going to be directed to send money in either through a wire transfer, which is when you go to a Western Union or a MoneyGram type of station,
mm-hmm,
and they're at all the drugstores, all the grocery stores and retailers, and it's very easy to transfer those funds electronically. The problem is, once you transmit those funds, they're gone.
Mm-hmm.
You can't stop it, you can't reverse it, and it's very difficult to trace because it's worldwide. What you think you're sending to New York,
wow,
may actually end up in Kingston, Jamaica,
wow,
Canada, or anywhere. So that's basically the family emergency or grandparent scam.
Okay. And I will say that I hear that one when I've done the programs at centers and senior clubs and groups and churches and wherever. There's always some that have heard about that, been aware of it, have been a victim of it. And, you know, they offer sometimes that name of the person unexpectedly, but some of the things we tell them is that caller wants you to not think. So they are pushy. They're, you know, do it now. We have to. We only have so much time to get out of jail, or I have to enter back the country. I have to be, you know, here or there. And again, in the beginning, when we said about the seniors and falling prey because they've got the money, the other thing is they somehow know that a lot of times that emotional and the relationship between the grandparent and the, you know, and the grandchild is there, and they want to help them. So it's that instinct. We've got some of the money, and they're so fast and pushy that we don't stop and think, well, when did they do that? Why don't I call my son or my daughter? You know, why don't I hang up and say, I'll call, you know? And it's unfortunate because they use all of those things. So that's the more popular one. What are some other ones that we're hearing a lot about?
Well, again, we also have the medical alert system scam where you're told you've won or someone in your family is providing you a medical alert system.
Oh, okay.
If you've fallen and you need assistance, you mm-hmm. push the button, which are great products. Mm-hmm. However, you're probably not getting one for free. They want you to sign up for the monitoring service, which is when they start to extract your personal information, your name, social security number, date of birth, account number from your credit card or bank. That's identity theft.
Okay.
You know, and we always tell folks, even if you haven't heard of the particular scam yet, you can still identify a lot of these scams by taking away that cover story.
Yes.
There's always
okay.
the story, grandma, I'm in trouble, this is the bank, there's someone using your credit card without authorization, mm-hmm. whatever it is,
mm-hmm.
stop and just pause. I always tell people, hit the pause button in your mind, take a minute and think.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't matter what the story is, but if you use the acronym of the word SCAM, S-C-A-M,
okay.
sudden contact, act now, money or information has been requested, 99% of the time it's a scam. So if you take away that emotional response of the story and you think mm-hmm. about the action, sudden contact, act now, money or information, most likely you're being scammed. Mm-hmm. You need to report it right away to the authorities.
Okay. So we have a couple of those. What other, I've also been at places where people have been in person, again, as you alluded to earlier, where somebody's driving down the road and, you know, sees a lady out front working, weeding something. And it was a couple in a car. They get out and the gentleman says, you know, I kind of noticed some shingles missing from the roof and it's not looking so good from this angle in the front of your house. And, you know, I do that. And, you know, whether they're working up the street or they're not working up the street, you know, if you want me to take a look, I'll be happy to either give you an estimate on fixing that. And they start to fast talk. Meanwhile, the second person gets out of the car and, you know, maybe the opposite sex. So the woman and the woman are starting to chat. The guy says, I'm going to go in the back of your house. I'll check the back roof, back side of your house and the roof, and heads that way. The other person keeps the homeowner occupied in conversation, and the other person, if the door's left open, they're in the house, up the stairs, get the valuables out, and okay, here's your estimate. Goodbye, we never hear from them again, and they're out personal belongings. Other scenarios, is that still common as well?
Very common. Okay. That would be known as either a distraction scam, where they're keeping one homeowner occupied while someone else enters the home and takes valuables. There's also another side to that. Home improvement fraud is a big problem, especially after storms in the mm-hmm. winter or the spring, damage to the property, the ice rips the gutter down a little bit,
mm-hmm.
and it probably needs one screw and it's fixed. But somebody driving by will stop and inquire to take the repair job on. They offer a great deal if you pay cash. They offer the fact that you're a senior, we're going to discount that work for mm-hmm. you, or we have material left over. These are all red flags. Never have a drive-up vendor that you haven't previously checked out. The Office of Attorney General, we have a registry for home improvement contractors. It's okay. the law in Pennsylvania. Anyone who's a professional doing home improvement contracting work here in the Commonwealth must register at the Attorney General's office. Always start with our agency. Check if it's a registered vendor. Get multiple bids from multiple vendors and get references and call them. Never deal with a drive-up contractor who just appears to point out problems at your home. It could cost you a lot more than you think.
All righty, we have a little bit of time left, so we talked. Any other scams before? Do you want to hit the financial exploitation a little bit?
Sure.
Okay.
We can hit on that briefly.
Okay.
Financial exploitation, again, we know it's someone who has either authority or mm-hmm. trust with the senior or a family relationship of some type or a friendship, And a lot of times the problems are immense. By the time we get notification that this is going on, the losses are staggering. Mm. This person, because they're in the home or in contact or in trust, they have a lot more access to a lot of the funds and the person's information. We find sometimes that power of attorney can be misused.
Yes.
Now, the power of attorney is a great document. It provides a lot of security and help, but it can also be used to steal someone's funds. Just because you instill a power of attorney with an agent doesn't mean that you're to lose sight of what's going on. It's still your money. You need to maintain control. You need to maintain statements and watch over your money, because if you ignore your money, it will go away. And we tell you that because it happens way too often. Family member, that caregiver comes into the home, mm-hmm. they start building a relationship, and next thing you know, actual family members are being written out of the will, perhaps. It's very, very troubling. We also see cases of isolation sometimes built around that, where the senior who used to be active at the senior center, mm-hmm. active in their church, always out and about, everyone stops seeing them. They lose contact. Well, sometimes the person that's stealing from them purposely sets that in motion not to be questioned, not for people
right.
to know what's okay. happening at the home. And also that can lead to other types of abuse, neglect, and other terrible situations. So we want you to report. We want you to have that information and contact authorities when you suspect any of these issues.
And don't be afraid to report it.
Absolutely.
And to stop it at that point. As a wrap-up, any quick key things before we go to resource information and end with that? How would you like to sum up
sure.
in two seconds?
No. Yep. The old sayings ring true. If it sounds too good to be true, it is. You never pay up front to receive a prize. You know, and never give out information to an incoming request.
Okay.
You know, I tell a lot of our folks, if the phone's ringing, don't go singing, right? You know, don't provide information to someone contacting you.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to be careful. And of course, anything that's in writing, remember the old saying, the large print giveth and the small print taketh away.
Okay.
Read every detail, okay. confirm everything, know who you're dealing with before you offer information or finances.
Okay, very good. I think the other key is to, as we close, I'm going to give some resources and to not be ashamed or embarrassed about the fact that that did happen. It can happen to anyone at any time, not just a senior, but certainly we have reasons to believe that they are focused on those that age group, but also that you need to report it. And there's several places you can report it. So I'm going to go to our slide right now. And obviously, for elder abuse contacts, you can call certainly your local police. You can dial 911. Our agency has protective services and can investigate those financial exploitation situations by calling our agency at 610-478-6500. Or the 800 number for elder abuse is 1-800-490-8505. And also, obviously, as Dave has mentioned numerous times, the Pennsylvania Office of Attorney General, they have a specific elder abuse hotline. It is 1-866-623-2137. And I would call there to report anything. I think the combination of also you do follow up. There is a whole process. If you're focused on going after the criminal, you want to know about it. You can't do it if you don't know about it. And you know, we again, even in local police departments can follow certain crimes
Absolutely.
And criminals around the community.
And
so.
Attorney General Kathleen Kane has really put a focus on our elder abuse unit. We're expanding our operation. We're trying to reach out to as many people in the community to advise them of what they can do and how we can assist. And we also assist the local and county agencies in law enforcement with these cases. So we are there. We're a resource. And we're looking to protect our older adults.
So we can report it, as well as we can call to double check on certain providers of service, like you said, the contractors and whatnot, to make sure that they're legitimate before you do go out and sign any kinds of agreements. I have up on the screen as our last time is I wanted to just thank Dave Shallcross, who is with us from the Pennsylvania Office of Attorney General. He's with the Education and Outreach Unit as the Elder Abuse Unit Leader. And I know we could be on for another 30 minutes at least, but I do appreciate your time with us for our program. And if you have any other questions, please feel free also to call the Berks County Area Agency on Aging at 610 478-6500. Thank you.